Welcome to the African Hub for Sustainable Creative Economies. My name is Avril Joffe. I'm at the University of the Witwatersrand in the Cultural Policy and Management Department, and I've been the lead investigator for the South African Hub, focusing on film and digital technologies. I'm here with Mariza Matshaya, who is a creative producer and a director and a scriptwriter and many other things, and she's going to share her journey in this wonderful sector with us. So Mariza, lovely to meet you and lovely to have you with us. Please share with us your journey as a filmmaker into this industry.
Okay, thank you. I'm so happy to be here, and thank you. Lovely to meet you too, Avril. So my journey in the film industry began in 2003 after a university degree at the University of Cape Town. I studied film and media and cultural studies. And basically, I've always known that I wanted to be a storyteller. So I went to varsity to pursue the career because obviously I wanted to have a paper that backed me and kind of like informed the decisions I make when it comes to storytelling. So I started off as a production assistant at Penguin Films, doing sitcoms, trained as a continuity person there as an assistant director. And I was kind of like trying to find my feet between scripted content and documentaries. And I think over the years, I just dabbled in such a way because I always knew that this is a career I wanted to have for a long time. And I wanted to make sure that I knew as much as possible about the different departments in every creative process, so that at least when the time came for me to journey into entrepreneurship and understanding the business of film, I'd have the opportunity to be able to create a slate of work that is beyond just one genre. So after Penguin Films, I did a little bit of documentaries with Plexus Films, worked on cultural content, art content, and then I started writing. So I started writing for series. I started conceptualizing more concepts for myself. And I started a little company that didn't go anywhere, which was basically just focusing on creating concepts, just creating concepts that were supposed to be revolutionary in the South African landscape, because I come from a researcher background. So I've always felt that I know what it takes to spark conversations, you know. But again, I always used it at the backdrop of the creative industries. So I then started the company I'm running now, which is Seismic Media, in 2015, but it was dormant because I was a freelancer and I was working on other people's projects. And the one thing that always bothered me is IP, like creating my own IP that belongs to my company so that I have longevity in the game. Because it's quite a difficult game. It's quite a difficult journey working as a freelancer. So I almost had to put an entrepreneurial hat to understand exactly what I was trying to achieve. I mean, it's been a long, hard journey. I haven't achieved the things that I want to achieve yet. But in terms of my background and where I am right now, I dabbled a little bit in digital media. I did a little bit of YouTubing, partner management. But I think now I'm in that space where I can grow a company and I understand the power of the creative industry and the creative economy, especially from the African continent.
That's wonderful to hear how you've taken some of the lessons you've learned in the industry and dabbling in all these different departments to recognize the importance of having your own company and owning your own IP. Can you tell us a little bit about some of the challenges of not owning your IP and what happens when you work, when you write scripts and you work on productions, and why is it so important to be an entrepreneur in this industry?
Okay, I think the challenge of not owning your IP is you basically work for hire. You get paid when jobs are in. You go through long bouts of unemployment, if you want to call it that, or breaks. There's basically a lack of consistency in the game. You can't say you're a full-time freelancer, you know, because contracts come and go. relationships change, commissions dry up, production companies have different visions. Sometimes they suck the IP out of you and they let you go once they see, oh no, it's just becoming too expensive. So you can't put value in other people's IP. When you're a freelancer and working for other people, you're just a salaried employer. So for me, what was intriguing was that I was realizing I was generating a lot of revenue for production companies, but I wasn't reaping the rewards on my side. So that's when I was like, the value in the creative industries is ownership. So if you can own the value chain, if you can own content, if you can monetize it, then you're in a better position. Because ultimately, I think when COVID hit, we were all knocked out for a completely long time. And we had to almost reevaluate how we're going to play the game. And yes, it hasn't fully recovered yet, but at least we're seeing that the funds are opening up again. There's opportunities again. The markets are opening up again. So there's a lot of interaction that's happening between the creative sector. And there's a lot of interest, obviously, in Africa as a booming continent and the demand for content from our side. So I think, yeah, so the importance of IP for me is literally about ownership and making sure that I build a body of work that can live, that can outlive me, you know, and also I can participate in different phases of the value chain.
And your company specialized in producing or all the aspects of filmmaking? Because I know you are a script writer as well and so on.
Yeah, so my company is a disruptive company. So that's why we call Seismic Media, you know. We specialize in content development because that's a skill we have. We do IP development, we do television executive development, you know, story development. We create our own characters. And that way, if we build a rich pipeline of projects in development, that means then when we get greenlit for production, we've got a body of work that we can flow into production with. But then also we on a journey to creating our own post-production facility so that we can retain post-production within the company as well. And then because we've networked over the years, we've spent a lot of time meeting broadcasters and distributors and decision makers over the last 10, 15 years. And we're now in a position to get them into a conversation without going to an independent distribution company. So we're able to leverage our own network in order to seal the deals instead of having a middleman introduce us to these key players, you know. So I think because it's taken us such a long time to establish ourselves as a production company, but it was almost a conscious decision. Because we needed to make sure that we could play in all the spaces to minimize risk when we're thinking of concepts, because we create our own production strategies that are well assessed. Our production teams, so we've got a very interesting business model in the sense that we work with freelancers who come to us to ask us to develop their concepts with them. So what we do is we co-finance them through your DTI rebates or through proposal development with bodies like the NFEF, so that at least we don't become a company that's dependent only on our concepts, you know. And we're very small. We're a team of three key creatives who churn out these concepts, you know, all the time. We've got a scriptwriter who also doubles up as a former commissioning editor. We've got a director who doubles up as a content producer, you know. So we're bringing in our skills of the last 20 years into this company in order to almost change the game in such a way that we boost our wealth in the creative sector, because there's a lot of money in the sector, you know, but it's very difficult to seal. So it's almost you have to be on a constant journey of grinding in order to like achieve that one commission that could be like a 30 million rand commission, you know. But you're also careful in the sense that when we go to these broadcasters, because we've got a fantastic rebate system in South Africa, we bring our co-financing so that we almost keep part of the project in the company, you know. So I think we've been very strategic in that light, and it's taken us a long time to get here, but I think it's built our character. It's allowed us to develop very compelling concepts without absorbing a lot of costs. So we work with a team of freelancers once we go into production, but we really try to keep our core team as Seismic Media very small so that you don't incur a lot of overheads. You know, so we've had to be disruptive in our thinking for business strategy, and we had to be disruptive in thinking of how we do productions and also how do we keep and retain ownership throughout the value chain. So retaining as much as possible in generating our company's so-called wealth.
So Mariza, one of the things our research showed during this process of developing the South African hub was how few women there were, especially Black women, running and owning their own companies. So you are one of those people. What would you, and clearly what you've spoken about is the relations of trust you've developed over time, the networking, the sense that you have a track record when you go to the broadcasters. What would your advice be to a young female Black woman who's wanting to be a filmmaker and like you, own their IP? What would you suggest they focus on? How important is networking, knowing the sector, all those things?
I think you can't underestimate the value of experience. You know, you can't underestimate going into somebody else's production company, looking at how they do things, looking at how they build teams, and looking at the key components that drive the film sector. You know, you can't just wake up and be like, I want to be a producer and think you're going to do it. You know, some of us, we don't have, I mean, a film is a very expensive hobby if you want to think of it that way. But ultimately, it is a business. It's show business, and there's no show without the business, and there's no business without a show. So ultimately, you have to remember that there's no shortcuts to success. Yes, you might get a lucky break and get a lot of work in the beginning of your career, but you might also burn out, you know? So for me, I think, especially for Black women, because I'm 100% owner of Seismic Media, you know, which is rare, but also an inspiration for me, because I've done partnerships in a production company. We have fallouts. And then there's fights about ownership and all of those things. And I wanted some sense of autonomy in decision-making, you know, when I started Seismic Media. I wanted to be able to choose the projects that speak to me, to choose the team that works best with me, and also for people to understand what my vision is, you know? So going back to your question about the importance of female-led companies, there are a lot of them coming up, you know, and unfortunately, we're not as supportive as people think we are. It's very competitive. We go to these international markets, we pretend like we don't know each other or have histories, you know. So it's very competitive, it's very catty, it's very clicky, it's very, I don't know, I don't want to call it, like, people seek people's validations and approvals. And it takes a long time to overcome that and realize that you don't need permission to play in the sector, you know. So for me, I think it comes with years of experience, it comes with education, it comes with understanding policies, understanding funding models, but it's not an overnight success. It definitely isn't, you know. So, and again, it's not a easy win, easy out. Because I've always said that what intrigues me is that with all these things that are coming up and unemployment, people always think, oh no, if you're unemployed, go to the film industry. It's the hardest industry to be in if you're going to stay a long time, you know? So I always advocate that stop training too many people to come in as producers if they don't have the business neck or the experience behind it, because you're going to leave a lot of people disappointed through these vigorous trainings, these CETA trainings, and inviting so many people to come have a seat at the table, because the table's quite small. You know, the players are ruthless. It's very competitive and it's very pretentious as well. You know, so you almost have to have a thick skin, and you'll go through these waves, and you just have to have staying power. You know, you have to have staying power. And I mean, for me, I've been in the game since I was 21. I'm turning 41 this year, and it feels like I'm right at the beginning, but I wouldn't swap the experience for anything.
So you sound like you're right at the end, because you've reached so many things you've wanted. But I agree, you're right at the beginning as well, because you've got a whole future ahead. So what does a future look like for Mariza Matshaya? What is your vision for, what would your ideal project be that you want to work on? How do you want to grow this company? What do you want it to be remembered for?
I want to be remembered for concepts and projects that changed perceptions. You know, I don't want to be remembered for creating the biggest budget production. You know, I want to be remembered for being a conversation sparker or changing perceptions in South Africa. Because I still feel, as much as there's a lot of opportunities, we still aren't creating content that shifts perceptions. You know, that's culturally significant for our sector, that spark real conversations, because film and TV and digital industries are a powerful, powerful medium and come with a lot of responsibility. There's so many conversations we haven't sparked yet, you know. The future for me right now is quite exciting, because I've got a documentary film that I'm making about an integrated dance company in South Africa, which has like a deaf choreographer and a wheelchair user as a dancer, and they are traveling the world, and I want people to know them, you know. So I'm a big advocate for artists. I love creating content around the arts. I think artists are a window to a society. The stories we tell, whether it's through dance, through film, through cultural significance, through documentary, we've got the power to change these perceptions we have in society, you know. So I love those kind of projects. I love breaking ground. I do want to create content that everyone would be like, oh my gosh, did you see that? You know, I'm working on a project that I'm trying to get into the streaming platforms, which sparks crazy conversations around religion and cult figures and the human need for connections, you know. So I've got a mixed bag of content that I want to create that is in different phases of development. But I also want things that resonate with us as a local audience, but have global appeal. So I want us to have a small window into South Africa through the content we create, but reach global audiences because of the universal storytelling.
Well, thank you, Mariza. Thank you so much for sharing this very inspiring conversation with us. And I can't wait to see the conversations that you spark in the future. And, you know, the African Hub for Sustainable Creative Economies is really about looking at how higher education institutions couldn't be more supportive and create more partnerships with the sector. And I think I can't wait to see what you do next. Thank you so much.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Avril. It was lovely talking to you.